Well, good morning. Oh, you can do better than that. Good morning. Welcome to Liberty Baptist Church. We're glad that you're here for our 8:30 time of worship. If you're a visitor, we're especially glad that you're here today. There's a card in the pew in front of you that says welcome. We'd love for you to take a few moments to fill that card out and put it in the offering plate, or you can give it to one of our ushers before you leave today. But we are glad that you're visiting with us. Well, a few things that I want to remind you of that are in your proclaimer, the first of which is tonight we have a very special presentation concerning, it is Lottie Moon Christmas offering season, and so tonight we have a very special drama presentation from Kirk and Patty Lytle at 6 o'clock, and it's a wonderful, they go all around and they tell the story of Lottie Moon, and if you or your family are interested or just want to see a good play there's a good article in the Proclaimer, and you can read about it there on the screen, but we're excited to learn more about how God used Lottie Moon literally to the ends of the earth, and so I hope that you would come back tonight at 6 and join us for that presentation. The second thing I'll mention is our men's Bible study is going to be tomorrow night at 7 p.m. Here at the church in the youth area. So please do, men, plan on being with us tomorrow night at 7 p.m. We are just kind of getting started back with men's Bible study, so don't worry about being behind. You can jump right in, and you're going to be right on time and up to speed with everyone else. So men, please do be here 7 p.m. tomorrow night for men's Bible study. The third thing I'll mention is Wednesday night dinner is going to be, we have Wednesday night supper here every week, but this week's going to be the special Thanksgiving Wednesday night supper, and so it is going to be, you can have Thanksgiving before you have Thanksgiving. So it'll be turkey gravy, green beans, mashed potatoes, and dessert, so you can go ahead and prime your stomach for Thursday by coming Wednesday night and eating Thanksgiving the first time before you eat it again on Thursday. Speaking of Thursday, we have two things going on. The Lottie Waddle 5K run and walk is going to be on Thursday at 9. And then the Turkey Bowl, which is our flag football game, is going to be at 10 out at Appomattox Elementary School. So please do join us for both of those events on Thursday. And I believe that is all for the announcements. There are more announcements. They are just in the Proclaimer, and you can read them at your leisure. Well, as we begin our time of worship, I would invite you to listen to the words of the Lord from Psalm 118, starting in verse 28. The Bible says this: "You are my God, and I will give you thanks. You are my God, I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever."
Come with thankfulness to glorify the Lord and give and praise his holy name. Let's stand together as we glorify our God together in song.
Father, Amen. today we want to lift thanks to you and to you alone. God, we realize that you are the one from whom all good things are given. And so, God, as we today, this Sunday, before Thanksgiving Day, we pray that we would use our time to prepare our hearts to not just be thankful for the things that you have so graciously given us, but, God, that we would be profoundly thankful to you alone. God, we thank you for the cross. We thank you for the Spirit that has been given. We thank you for the church that has been born. And God, we pray that today that you would fill our hearts with true, genuine, authentic, Spirit-given thanksgiving. God, we pray you'd help us. In Jesus' name, amen.
God in our time of need, for he is faithful to provide all that we need. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Let's stand together as we sing of our God's great faithfulness.
Thou changest not thy compassion. Father and our God, we come to you again today just praising your holy name. And Father, thank you for your grace. Thank you for your love. Thank you for another day to come here to worship you. Father, I pray that you'll fill our hearts, our minds. Father, just open them up, Father, so that we can receive the message that Rusty has for us today, Father. We pray that your Holy Spirit will just be with us, Father. Draw us closer to you. I pray that your Holy Spirit will be with Rusty as he brings your message to us. I pray that if it's anybody here today, Father, who does not know you as their loving God and Savior, I pray that today will be the day that they will just come forward and turn it all over to you. So we thank you for these tithes and offerings now that we're about to receive, and pray, Father, that these tithes and offerings will be used for the ongoing of your kingdom. We thank you and we praise you again, O Father, and all these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Well, today is Thanksgiving Sunday on Thursday of this week. I hope you are planning some time around a table with your family. I hope that in this week, especially on Thursday, that you're able to deepen some family bonds and some relationships. You know, this time of year, you're either going to love it or hate it. Night falls earlier. Temperatures get colder, which means you get the privilege of being inside with people for longer periods of time. And so this is a very good time to think about Thanksgiving and to think about all the good things that God has done for us. You know, this year we have gotten a running start into Thanksgiving Sunday. I don't know if you've known that or not. We are today on our final message of the Work It Out series. We realize that there are many obstacles to our thankfulness. And if there weren't many obstacles to our thankfulness, then most of us would be more thankful. And so what we are trying to do is we are committing not to just put on a plastic face. We're committing not to just develop contrived thankfulness, but we desire to develop a disposition of thankfulness that is God-directed, that is Jesus-focused and that is Spirit-given. And I think nothing short of this is what the Christian should aim towards. Now, the good news about Thanksgiving Sunday is that the topic of Thanksgiving, I have to preach about it. I guess I don't have to, but I do it. I have to look at this subject every year, at least for a Sunday, which means that on the topic of Thanksgiving, most of you have heard more messages on Thanksgiving than you've heard on a lot of other topics because of this holiday. And I just think, at least for me, sometimes I assume that I already know what the Bible has to say and what Christian Thanksgiving is all about. And so I think, well, I don't really need to listen today. It's Thanksgiving message. The pastor's going to tell us the same old thing he's always told us, and we're going to have the same old reaction, forget it about as fast, and we'll pick it up next year. You see, maybe we ought to do something different than that. Now, this is probably the way many of us, myself included, can devolve into thinking about thankfulness. Listen to this, okay? Here it is. Here's the way most people, I think about being thankful. Most people think about being thankful as little more than an accentuation of the positive. Here's the way it goes. I tried to write it out in propositional form. You ready? Every situation is a mix of good and bad, right? Every situation is a mix of good and bad. So we can choose to be thankful for the good and minimize the bad, or we can choose to maximize the bad and minimize the good. There it is. There's your Thanksgiving messages that have probably come at you for years and years and years. There it is. So I'm done, you say. Now that's what most, and so I've just held that up before myself, and I said, well, let's just take a glance at that again. So here it is. Every situation is a mix of good and bad. We can choose to be thankful for the good and minimize the bad, or we can choose to maximize the bad, minimize the good. And there it is. And actually, I heard a sermon this week on the radio that was exactly that by a Christian pastor. And to be honest, I thought at the end of the message, you know, I probably ought to focus more on the blessings and less on the negatives. But then my heart began to ask, is that all Christianity has to offer? Because I'll just be honest with you, there's nothing distinctively Christian about that. It's good. It's nice. But there's nothing distinctively Christian about that. Quite frankly, I don't even need to believe in God to do that. I don't need the cross to do that. I don't need the Spirit to do that. I just merely looking for positive things and minimize negative things and live a more happy, positive existence. So I thought, now, by the way, don't misunderstand me. Focusing on blessings is a good thing. Okay, so that's a good place to start. And hopefully, since all of you have about 10 to 15, some of you have like 40 Thanksgiving messages, you know, as part of your repertoire already, that you don't need that message again. So I'm going to assume that you know that one. And I would say that's a good starting place. But I do not believe that our discipleship journey should end at this place. I think the Christian should be able to have hope and thankfulness, not just by digging around in situations and going, oh, there's a good thing. Oh, there's another good one I can be thankful for. Well, there's another one. Well, all these negative, let's just shift those out. There's another. If I don't think the Christian just has that. Here's the thing. I believe that a Christian's thankfulness is not situation-focused. This is a misstarting point. A Christian's thankfulness does not start in sifting out a situation. A Christian's thankfulness starts as he stares into the person of God himself. That's a very different. Now, you've got to be a Christian to do this. A Christian's thankfulness is God-directed, and a Christian's thankfulness is a thankfulness towards God that even all the troubles and all the bad and all the sin that is around them, the Christian can be thankful that there is a God. He doesn't have to minimize it, by the way. He can be thankful that there is a God who is capable of redeeming it. Now, that's a lot different. There is a God who is greater than the good and the bad. That there is a God who is, and a God who can take any trouble, who can take any struggle, who can take any level of brokenness and provide for it wholeness. Now, that's more robust. See, that's not a pushing away of the problems. That is a setting in the problem, seeing the negatives at every level for what they are, and saying, thank you, God, that there is not one thing that will come in my life that the victory of the cross has not overcome. That is more robust, church. That is not a sifting around and saying, let's just accentuate the positive. By the way, by the time the story ends, it will all be new. You understand this? Boy, that is so different. That is so robust. You know, one of the things I'm thankful, and Barbara, I'm sorry to bring this up. I should have warned you. I have seen good men in this church, Jack Caldwell being one. Every Thanksgiving, he would quote the same verse to me. And then he would struggle with it. I would watch him struggle with it. Here's the verse. 1 Thessalonians 5:18. He would say, he would quote this, give thanks in everything, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. And I would see Jack Caldwell trying to understand this verse. Because he'd say, Rusty, it doesn't say give thanks for everything. It says give thanks in everything. If he told me that once, he told me 1,000 times. I said, Jack, I think I've gotten it. But maybe I didn't. Because there's another little word in that verse. It says give thanks in everything. You know why we can give thanks in everything? Because there's another in the verse. Because we are in Christ Jesus. That's why. Give thanks in everything, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Because no matter what situation I am in, if I am in Christ, all things will work together for good. And I don't have to just look for the good in the present. I can anticipate the profound spiritual blessings poured out for me in Christ. And that is the basis for my thankfulness. That is so different, church. And there are good things and blessings that lay all around us, but may I say, no eye has seen and no ear has heard what God has prepared for those who love Him. And that basis changes my thankfulness. It is not situation driven, it is not good accentuating. It is God-directed, and our thankfulness is already realized because we believe what God has said He will actually accomplish what He said He will do. So here's the deal. We're going to finish our Work It Out series, and I will say that Psalm 88 is probably the most depressing psalm of any psalm we have looked at in this whole litany of psalms. Actually, the book of Psalms, some of you didn't know this, is actually divided into 5 sections. Right there in your Bible, it tells you that there have 5 sections. We're in the 3rd section of the 5 sections. The 150 are divided into 5. I didn't do it. The biblical authors did it. And book 3, the 3rd section of the Psalms, is probably the one where the psalmist struggles the most. And rather than the psalmist's struggle decrease as this 3rd section rolls on, it actually increases. And it almost gets more depressing and depressing and depressing by the time it ends. I mean, the situation of the psalmist gets more depressing and depressing. But by the time we get to Psalm 89, which is the conclusion of the 3rd section, it's almost as if all of these negative things are happening to the psalmist, and this is his final word.
May the Lord be praised forever. Amen and amen. And that just ends right in the middle of a bunch of struggle. And you think, how did he work that out? Because nothing changes for the psalmist except his heart. So let's go there, Psalm 88, where we will see not how we can just accentuate the positive, as good as that is, but we can see how we can develop thankfulness in all things. Here it is, the first point. To work through troubles, we should remember that God is a God of salvation when we are experiencing troubles. Verse 1 says, notice the psalm thunders out with the one thing he knows to be true about God, Lord God of my salvation. He starts it out. He thunders out of the gate with that statement. But here comes his situation. I cry out before you day and night. May my prayer reach your presence. Listen to my cry, for I have had enough troubles, and my life is near Sheol, or the grave. I am counted among those going down to the pit. I am like a man without strength, abandoned among the dead. I am like the slain lying in the grave, whom you no longer remember, and who are cut off from your care. You have put me in the lowest part of the pit, in the darkest places, in the depths. Your wrath weighs heavily on me. You have overwhelmed me with all of your waves. Let's take a break. Selah. All right, he needed a break, didn't he? Now notice, if we are keeping, you notice the first thing the psalmist did not do? He did not do what? Accentuate the positive. He didn't listen to a single positive thing in this whole thing, except this. The only positive thing he had was this, Lord God of my salvation. That's all he said. The only good he could find in his whole situation is there was a God who was bigger than his situation and able to redeem his situation. Other than that, he couldn't evidently find anything very positive laying around in the situation. I mean, notice this. This is not a temporary setback, you know. Some people, there are some people who are so wonderfully positive, and I really do enjoy being around them, but some people can have like 1,000 failures, and they still, it's a temporary setback. No, it's not. It's really more than that. I promise you. So this isn't a temporary setback for the psalmist. I mean, he's evidently, I don't know what his situation is, but he's been pushed through so many struggles that they just don't seem to stop. You know, there are some times in life where one problem comes, you think, okay, I can handle this one. Another one comes, I'm handling it. Another one comes, you're like, okay, all right, God, I don't need any more. And then about 3 more come. You understand? This is usually when they call the pastor, you know? You know? When the 3 more come, they can't handle. That's usually when they call the pastor. So I see a lot of people in this condition. And the psalmist is here. In earthly terms, the only thing the psalmist can hold on to is Lord, God of my salvation. That's all he's got. That's all he can see. By the way, let's think about this. You know, a God of salvation. You know, Christianity is unique. It focuses on salvation. You know, not all world religions focus on salvation. That's not even their goal. Christianity is unique in that it has a vision of a saving God. It's unique in that way. I mean, the whole Bible is about God being a saving God. He saves Noah and his family from a flood. He saves Abraham from among the nations. He rescues the children of Egypt out of Egypt and puts them in a land. He's a saving God. He protects his people from their oppressors. When Jesus comes on the scene, he comes to seek and to save those who are lost. He calls the church into existence only to push them out to bear the message of salvation to the world. And the end of the Bible ends with God saying, now salvation has been accomplished. The Bible is a Bible of salvation. Now, this is a very important point. Salvation, no matter what your present situation, for the Christian, salvation is your future. I mean, that's the case. No, only the Christian can say, Romans 8:28, we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the call according to His purpose. The psalmist can set in a situation in which there is no apparent good, and he can say, God, but I know good is coming because you are a God of salvation. You see, I can give thanks in everything because I know what God will do. It's not situational. It is God-focused and God-directed. Although we can see what God does in the present, it does not depend upon that. Now notice, the psalmist keeps going. He's got that anchor. But the situation still doesn't get better. And so he has to think about how is God going to really enact all of this. The second point is, to work through troubles, we should realize that there are no troubles that God cannot reverse. This is actually what it means for God to be a God of salvation. Verse 8, the psalmist keeps going with his struggle. You have distanced my friends from me. You have made me repulsive to them. I am shut in and cannot go out. My eyes are worn out from crying. Lord, I cry out to you all day long. I spread out my hands to you. If you don't think his situation's gone bad, listen to his two final questions. Do you work wonders for the dead? Because that's where I'm going. Do departed spirits rise up and praise you? Selah. I told you this was the most depressing psalm of all here, isn't it? You agree with me on that much, don't you? That this one isn't going up, it's going down. Notice what the psalmist is facing. He's facing a difficult situation. He's facing a situation where God is not intervening, at least not in this moment. The friends are distancing. You see this? He's tired. Basically, the psalmist says this, my eyes don't have any more tears to cry, my mouth has no more prayers to pray, and my hands have no more strength to be lifted. This is where he's at. And so he says, at this moment, I don't think this is going to stop before I die. Isn't this what you, I mean, you tell me. You're reading the Bible along with me. Doesn't this seem to be what the psalmist is saying? I don't think this is going to stop until I die. And then he asks the questions, well, is there going to be thankfulness after I die? It's what he's already asking. So I want us to get one more thing into view. The second thing to get into view is the troubles of a sinful world. You know, I think thankfulness, for some, we struggle with it because we haven't gotten this, at least I haven't gotten it sometimes. You know, the famous verse in Job, it says, Job 14:1, man born of woman is a few days and, anybody know the rest of this? Full of troubles. I mean, this is the way life comes at us. And if my thankfulness is based upon only the positive things in every situation, some days will be harder than others. Are you seeing what I'm saying? And thus, thankfulness is going to fluctuate quite a bit. If it's based upon this, and so here's the truth, our thankfulness is God directed, and our thankfulness is really partially for the blessings of this moment, but more profoundly for the blessings of a future moment, isn't it? I mean, here's the bad news. All that you need and all that you desire will not be fulfilled here. It just won't happen. Listen, you will die. This isn't a Thanksgiving message, is it? You will die. Here it is. I'm serious. You will die with unfulfilled dreams. That's the way it's going to go. You will die thinking, well, I'd like to do one more thing. I'd like to have one more thing. I'd like to have one more. I'd like to. And you're going to die. That's what's going to happen. I'm breaking it to you. But folks, our thankfulness is to God. And God has spoken so clearly. He knows this world is insufficient to fulfill our deepest longing. And He has provided for us a new world. He has provided for us a future in which every single one of those longings will be fulfilled. And so when you feel yourself going that direction, you can echo with the psalmist, will we praise you from the grave? And God says, yes. You see, this is, you see, our thankfulness, I guess, in this way is situational. It's situational for a future situation. We know that there is a God who has promised us relief and bliss and thankfulness and joy and peace and communion like we have never experienced before, but He promises that we will experience it. And you say, man, in everything give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Because every one of those things I named are the benefits of being in Him. Now, the psalmist wraps it up. He gets no better, by the way. He just begins to realize that God's ultimate act of salvation will lie in His future after the grave, not in this moment. The third and final point, to work through troubles, we can anticipate that the places of greatest trouble can be the places of greatest salvation. Well, I really want to talk a lot about this. Verse 11, notice the psalmist's questions. Will your faithful love be declared in the grave? Your faithfulness in Abaddon, which is another word for grave? Will your wonders be known in the darkness, or your righteousness in the land of oblivion? I don't know if you ever heard the word oblivion in the Bible. There it is. Go into oblivion. There it is. But I call to you for help. Lord, in the morning my prayers meet you. Lord, why do you reject me? Why do you hide your face from me? From my youth I have been afflicted and near death. I suffer your horrors. I am desperate. Your wrath sweeps over me. Your terrors destroy me. They surround me like waters all day long. They close in on me from every side. You have distanced loved one and neighbor from me. Darkness is my only friend. You only wish the text kept going, but it stops. There it is. Actually, by the way, the next psalm, however, I believe gives the answer. The question, the psalmist here is going into the grave. It's where he's going. By the way, Psalm 89 will answer it. I'll sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. It's the next psalm. But let's stay here for a moment. So the psalmist is really in the bad. So if we can be thankful in this situation, we can be thankful in any situation. The psalmist realizes God will not intervene in this most difficult situation. You see it? He's not coming. God is not coming to relieve the psalmist in this earthly situation. He is not. It's right there. He's not coming. And so the psalmist has to go to the big questions. Here, you know, you go to the big questions when you can see no temporary solution. And here it is. Will your faithful love be declared in the grave? Or will your wonders be known in darkness, your righteousness in the land of oblivion? He's asking the big questions now, right? There will be no intervention. There will be no intervention for the psalmist. He will die. He's straight up seeing that 100%. By the way, you know, this psalm puts on us a very tough reality. Here it is. The hard truth is some people suffer and even die, sometimes in horrible circumstances, and they cry out to God who does not desire to relieve their struggle until eternity. I've been with these people. You understand this? That's the truth. Life happens this way. But if I can figure out how to be thankful in this situation, I think I've got it. What do you think? Now, I won't know if I've got it until it happens. You understand this? This is get a one shot at it. But this is a real place for some thinking. Did you know that our greatest trouble can be our place of greatest victory? I want you to listen. I'm going to throw out a few more statements and I'm going to wrap this up. C.S. Lewis was famous for making this phrase. C.S. Lewis was an old bachelor. He finally married a woman. About the time he loved her, she died. That was his life. And he reflected on that, and he came up with this famous phrase that his suffering, the suffering of losing his wife, was part of his joy. By the way, his wife's name was Joy. He said his struggle to see her die was only so acute because of the amount of love they shared. You think about this. You understand this? That if you never really grieve over anything, you've never really had anything. If you're just, nothing phases you, then you've never loved, you've never cared, you've never, you know what I'm saying? But he says the suffering was part of his joy. You know, just think about your moments of greatest joy. Think about your moments of greatest thankfulness. Let's just take a case study example. Maybe you're here today and your children are coming to see you for Thanksgiving this year. But you thought that they might not because one of your children had a health scare and you thought they might die. One of your child told you he'd be away. Another child had been estranged from you. You understand? But when they sat around the table, one's alive, one's here, one's reconciled. May I say that the suffering is part of the joy, right? You will sit at that table much more thankful, right, than you would had none of those things happened, had none of those events occurred. Now, here's the deal. The Christian can be imaginative. Just think about when life deals you the deepest blow and you find yourself in the deepest pit. You can think, God, thank you, because I cannot even imagine the joy I will feel when you rescue me from this situation. I mean, listen to this. When we see a person who is riddled in pain, we can tell them that God has told them He is making a world with no more pain. And a person can sit in pain and say, thank you, God, that you have said, and I will make a world where there is no more pain. When we see a person who is riddled in deep grief, we can whisper to that person that God is going to make a world in which there is no more death. And when we see a person who is saying, this world just doesn't do it for me, we can say, but there is a God who is going to make all things new. And now listen to where we're ending. We are now sitting, maybe, in our deepest struggle and profoundly thankful, not just for the good, but we can even see the bad in a different light, because we think that this deep gash will become a monument to God's salvation. I don't know if you believe this, church. Listen to the way the psalmist, this is the way it's going to go for the psalmist. You ready for it? The psalmist is dying, and he's saying, will your faithful love be declared among the grave? He dies. But then listen to what happens. Then it says, for this perishable must put on imperishable, and this immortal must put on immortality. And when this perishable has been clothed with imperishable and the mortal clothed with immortality, then the saying that has been written, death has been swallowed up in victory. You see with the psalmist? He's going down only to come right back up. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? But thanks be to God, there it is, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. There's the basis of salvation and thankfulness. It's not just present blessings, but it is the focus of future blessings that have been promised by God. And no matter what happens, I know what's going to happen. And I can give thanks in everything, for this is God's will for me, because now I know what it is to be in Christ Jesus. Church, we need not to have the same old tired messages. The Word of God is living and active. And Christian discipleship calls us to something deeper, something real. And so I would just say, Christian, I don't know what your situation is, but my final question is, will you work out in prayer whatever is hindering your thankfulness? And may you stay there and let God orient you back to His ways. And I think we can get there. I do believe we can get there. I'm going to try to get there. I'm not there yet, I promise you, but I'm working on it. And I hope you can get there. And that we actually hear what the Bible says, and then we try to do it. Listen, if you're here today and you say, Rusty, I am struggling, well, may I say that the number one thing you need is nothing situational. You need a Savior. That's what you need. You need to say, God, I don't have it in myself to solve a single problem. I can't solve the most fundamental problem, which is my distance from you. I heard that you sent Jesus to die on a cross for my salvation. If you're here today and you need God's salvation, it is available free of charge. You just have to say, God, I am a sinner and I need your salvation. The Bible says He will give it to you. He will put you in Christ Jesus. And church, let's attempt to hear the Word of God and ask the Spirit of God to make us be obedient to one very simple phrase: give thanks in everything, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Let's learn from the Spirit how we can actually do this very thing. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we ask you that you would not give us a contrived, plastic thankfulness. God, we pray that you would give us not a thankfulness that is dependent upon any present situation. Although, God, we know that even today, each one of us have been given so much grace and so much mercy and so many blessings. God, even to live here in America in relative safety with full stomachs, God, you have blessed us beyond what we can ever deserve. But God, these blessings are nothing to be compared to that which you will do in us. And God, we wait. We wait. We say, even so come, Lord Jesus, make real that which you've promised us, and may that be the source of our thankfulness. We pray you'd help us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together.
I once was lost.
our final prayer. Heavenly Father, all the grace and all the mercy and all the love we feel in this moment, God, we praise you that it is only a speck of that which you will give to us in the future. God, even in this moment, we don't have the capacity to even understand the good that has been laid up for those who love you. We hear that eye has not seen, nor ear has heard, what God has prepared for those who love him. And so, God, in this moment, as we can grasp ever so slightly your blessings, God, our hearts well up in thanksgiving because we know more is to come. And so, God, may we live right here in the blessings promised to us in Christ. And God, may we not just be thankful for situational goodness, but God, may we be thankful for divine goodness that has barely been seen. And God, we say, even so come, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.